Good morning. Welcome to our online Community Reformed Church worship experience. Been reminded again, maybe in some ways, how when we miss out on some of the things that we really appreciate, when we don't have them, we recognize how important they are. And I wish that I could see your face. I wish that I could give you a hug and have that type of connection, and just really am aware of how much I think at times I've taken that for granted, being able to connect with people in a real physical way, and I think that's a big deal. And so I hope that this whole flat chip thing is just a reminder for you that those connections matter, not just with me but with each other, and that we're all working hard to take advantage of those connections in our home, but also to use Zoom and Skype and Facebook and other avenues to try to connect with each other. But sure, glad that you've joined us. Want to welcome Bell Tower Reformed Church too, as they're participating with us in these videos, and just a welcome to all of you. Glad that you've joined us. A couple quick announcements before we move into the prayer and worship and the message. One is just to encourage you to do your part in remaining connected. And so here's a couple different ways that you can be involved with us. Facebook is obviously you're on right now, but follow Community Reformed Church of Charlevoix. And we also have recently opened an Instagram account, and you can follow that at CRC of CVX. And one of the unique parts about that is we're doing a little deal that if you follow Instagram here in the next week, that you are put in the hat for an opportunity to win one of Puzzles That Rock's new puzzles. That's Lisa Matt Claflin's business, and so we really want to encourage people to get involved with Instagram. So if you're willing to do that, we'll have an opportunity to win a puzzle, and some of us I know are doing puzzles during this kind of unique time. And also be sure that you continue to check in at our website. We're trying to update that each week, but that's another way to remain connected. And then a couple things that are coming up this week. We're going to do another opportunity to pray together as a church through Zoom. That went really well this past week and was really a deep and meaningful experience. So we're going to do that again this Wednesday, and we're actually going to offer another opportunity. So we're going to pray together at 11 a.m., but we're also going to do it at 5:30 p.m. And so you'll be receiving a link via email, and we'll definitely try to put that link too on our Facebook page. And so all you'll need to do at 11 a.m. or 5:30 p.m., or if you want to join us for both, you sure are welcome to. You just need to click on that link, and that will help you to get connected. And you will need a video on your computer or phone or tablet to be able to connect with us in that way. But really encourage you to join us for that. It was a real meaningful time to connect together, to see each other, and to pray with each other. And one other, just we received some feedback regarding sound on these services, and we sure appreciate that. We're working hard to try to improve our sound. We've done a few things this week that we're trying to see if that works, but continue to give us feedback. But one of the suggestions is, if you're on a computer or a tablet, sometimes headphones or earbuds will help that sound to improve. I know if you're gathering with more than one person, that's going to be hard to do, but just encourage you to work hard at your part too, that headphones and earbuds may be a way to address that. Or computers tend not to have great sound, so you may have to adjust some of your settings on your computer to improve that sound. So we're working hard at that. We appreciate your feedback. Keep giving it. So I've been working through the book of Proverbs during my devotional time, and just found it to be very, very helpful as it talks about knowledge and understanding and some of the challenges that we face in that. Let me read to you what Proverbs 15, verse 14 says, kind of to lead us into worship today. It says this: "The mind of one who has understanding seeks knowledge, but the mouths of fools feed on folly." You know, part of the challenge for all of us is what to believe. Hearing inundated with all sorts of information and all sorts of opinions. And that part of the work for each of us is, what do we really know to be true? And as we step into worship today, I want to remind us that even though sometimes the circumstances around us change, even though our understanding of all that's taking place at times changes. And it sure seems like this past week, so much of what's going on in regards to this virus has gotten much more serious. That we're hearing news of some very significant and devastating type consequences taking place. And that's only amping up the fear. But I hope that as we step into this time of worship together, we remember that even though things around us may change, some things will never change. And that we believe in a God who is with us. So let me read these final words from Isaiah chapter 41 to lead us into our time today. So this is Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10. Here's something we know to be true because of who God is. Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, I will help you, I will uphold you with my victorious right hand. Let's pray together. God, we give you thanks for what we know to be true. That you are here, that you are God, that you are working, that there is nothing that you can't handle. And that though we feel overwhelmed at times, though we don't know what tomorrow and the next week always will bring, we do know that regardless of what happens, you will be with us. So Father, may this time be a time we remember what's true. That our knowledge in you grows and our trust in you grows. Thank you for the gift of your word. Thank you for the way that you've been preparing Chris Mackey today to bring that word to us. So help us to open ourselves up to that and help us to respond in obedience to this word. Thank you for the gift it is and for the way that it reminds us of what's true no matter what. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning, church fam. Chip just said in his prayer, my name's Chris. I'm on staff here at church, for those of you who don't know me out there. And I get the opportunity to share a little bit with you guys today, just something that's been on my heart, and I'm excited to kind of jump into it. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take Flat Chip, and I'm going to move him so he can maybe learn a little bit here while we're doing this sermon. So today we're going to be jumping into the book of Romans, and we're going to be kind of hanging out mostly on five verses, Romans 5, 1 through 5, if you want to open up your Bibles. I'm going to have it up on the screen behind me as well as we kind of walk through this, but it's going to be, I think, a message that is really applicable for us today. The word suffering, it's a very, very interesting word. I'm curious, when you see this word suffering, what is it that you think of? You can even type it in the comments below on Facebook right now if you want to share and kind of start talking a little bit on Facebook, build a little community right there. I'd be curious to know how you view suffering. What is it? What does it look like to you? What is the imagery that pops up when you think of this word suffering? You know, what got me on this word this week is on Facebook and on social media, the three different social media platforms I'm involved with, this word has popped up a lot. And people have been trying to define what suffering looks like and how they interact with suffering. Some people think that right now, in the midst of what's happening in our life, in this craziness in our community and in our country and in our world, that this is suffering that is going on. And then, of course, because it's social media, there's all these arguments that break out that this isn't suffering. What you're going through right now, staying at home, isn't suffering. Being locked in a house with the same five people, the same two people, that's not suffering. Although some people think it's suffering, They start to say, it's nothing like 9/11. It's nothing like Vietnam or World War II or the Great Depression or what Anne Frank went through locked up in a room. Like, there's so many different things I've read that have said, no, this is what suffering is. For me, what's really interesting about this word is, as followers of Jesus, we're asked to suffer. And Paul talks to us very clearly about what suffering looks like to us and for us. And so today we're going to try to get our worldview tuned into what a suffering looks like from a biblical perspective as Paul talks to us about. So we're going to dive right into the scriptures, starting at Romans 5, 1 through 5. It says this, therefore, since we have been justified through faith. Now, like always, whenever there's a therefore going into a piece of scripture, it's really, really important for us to know what is said beforehand. Because we've got to understand that before we can move forward, because the setup to this is really important for us. So I'm going to do my best really quickly to define that therefore. You see, the first five chapters of Romans, Paul is talking about a lot of deep things, a lot of theological concepts and words, a lot that we could deep dive into for a very long time. But I'm going to try to sum it up as easily as I can. In the first five chapters, Paul has told us to move from sin towards Jesus. And so this is what we need to know moving forward. The word therefore is asking us to understand this, that we are moving, that we have moved from the idea of we have sin in our lives and we have been forgiven because we have taken steps towards Jesus. Okay? And so then from there, the scripture is continued like this. Therefore, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand, and we boast in the hope of the glory of God. You see, so Paul is telling us that therefore, if you have moved from sin towards Jesus, we are given a couple different things. We are given peace, and we are given hope. And so, setting this whole thing up, Paul is asking us to basically know three things, and we're going to revisit this several times here in the next few minutes because it's really, really important for us to get that if we have known Jesus and we've moved away from sin towards Jesus, that we have peace and hope. Now, this word peace is a fascinating word. The other day around the dinner table, I looked over at my three daughters and I just asked them, I said, hey girls, how would you define peace? Just curious how the perspective from from some younger people would do. But they did an amazing job. And I want to share with you kind of what they said. They used two phrases in their description that I think are really helpful in us understanding peace. One of them said, it's a quiet happiness inside. Another one of them said, it's being still inside. And that's how you experience peace. And I like both of those because Jesus offers us this sense of peace when we enter into this. I mean, remember, we're going to be talking about suffering. Suffering is coming in a conversation here. But before we can get there, it's really good for us to understand the peace that is given when we move from our sin towards Jesus. He gives us these things, and he gives us a hope. And we're going to revisit hope in a little bit. So, what Paul is doing is he's setting us up here. He's wanting us to know all these three important things. One, that we move from sin towards Jesus. And when we do that, therefore, something happens. We have peace and hope. Because what Paul is doing is he's setting us up for a really difficult conversation. One that's really hard for us to wrap our minds around. One that when we read it for the first time, you go, really? We're asked to do what? And this is what it is. The scripture that we're looking at today goes on to say this. Paul says, not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings. Rejoice in our sufferings. That's really difficult to hear, isn't it? Because how are we supposed to rejoice when we are in the midst of sufferings? How are we supposed to say yes when we are in the pits of suffering? It's like Paul doesn't truly understand the things that we're going through. And trust me, I know that there are sufferings that are going on, not only to do with this pandemic that we're involved with right now, but there's also sufferings on a very personal daily level. It's like when you read this, you say, you don't understand the how am I supposed to rejoice in not being able to financially provide for my family? How am I supposed to rejoice when I've suffered loss that you don't even know? How are we supposed to rejoice when I am in the midst of a relational thing that is just destroying my family? How am I supposed to rejoice in the midst of divorce? How am I supposed to rejoice in the midst of the hardship that I am in right now? It's like Paul doesn't understand. But before we can understand rejoice, let's dig into what he means by sufferings a little bit here. Because that word is a very interesting word that he uses. It actually has several different meanings. This is the English translation of that. But when you dig into what that word really means, there's words like I'm pressed, I'm squeezed, I'm crushed. It actually means to break apart. And so there's this idea of brokenness and being pressed and crushed attached to this word. It's a hard piece of scripture to understand as we do this. But what he's asking us to do is to understand that there is something that's coming with this. He's asking us to, I think, understand both perspective and proximity when it comes to sufferings. That when we suffer, when we're squeezed and pressed and crushed, when we are broken people, when that's the state we're in, it's important for us to gain perspective. And the perspective is your point of view that you hold. It's something that comes from peace and hope. Does that remind you of the first verse? That when we have the right perspective, when we have moved from sin towards Jesus, and we have that peace and we have that hope, and we're looking at things through that lens, then we are gaining the right perspective in how to move forward with our life. And if we don't have the perspective and viewing that through the lens of peace and hope, the perspective is going to be skewed. And so it's important that when we think about sufferings, we look at it through that lens of peace and hope. He's also, I think, asking us to look at it through proximity, which means that often when we're in the midst of suffering, when we are in the first throes of the destruction of being broken apart and crushed and squeezed. When we're in the midst of that, sometimes we don't think very clearly because we're so close, because it's going on. Sometimes we need a little bit of space and time to understand what is going on. And giving ourselves freedom to take a deep breath and to give ourselves some space to just think and process and have time, some proximity to the situation, is a healthy move for us to do, so that we don't overreact. We don't react out of fear. We don't react out of impatience. We don't act out of anger, which when we do react out of those things, it's not coming from a place of peace and hope. It's coming from a place of anxiety and fear. And so we need to sometimes give ourselves that proximity and space. Something else I'd like to share, which I just find really fascinating, that this word suffering, the being pressed and crushed and broken apart, this word is actually used also when it comes to olive presses in the Bible. I have a couple images here for you to see, but you can see that there's a hole here, a trough, and they would fill this trough with olives, and then this big stone would roll around and squeeze and crush the olives. Another one that you can see, these are actually individual plates that are stacked with olives, and they would screw these down and it would press them down. They would crush them down. And this is the idea of what suffering looks like. This is the verbiage from the Bible that they attach it to, this idea of the olive. And what's really interesting about that is what comes from that. Theda Williams, when she was just in Israel, she brought back some olive oil for me. And when I was in Israel, I had some of this olive oil, and it is some of the world's best olive oil. The flavor is amazing. It is so good. And what this is saying, this verse is saying that yes, there is crushing and pressing and destruction that happens, like in an olive that is being crushed. But the end result, what you get, is this pure, beautiful oil that is useful and glorious to have. And this is all the setup that Paul is giving us to understand before we move forward. You see, Paul wants us to know, again, if you know Jesus, if you have moved from sin towards Jesus, if you are given His peace from knowing Jesus, if you are given His hope from knowing Him, when you suffer, you are not like other people. We are not like other people. We don't suffer the same way. We are not broken the same way. We are not hurt the same way, because we have something else that we are able to lean into in the times of suffering. Possibly what you're going through now, what you've gone through in your past, whatever suffering looks like to you, we go through it differently. And Paul has done all this work to set up our understanding moving forward in this verse. He wants us to know that we do it differently. So, coming back to the verse, why do we rejoice? Why can Paul write, we rejoice in our sufferings? It's because when we have the right perspective, when we have the right proximity, when we are crushed just like the olive, we know the other side of it. We have an understanding that when we walk through this suffering, and the other thing is going to produce something in us, an oil that only can come through the power of Jesus and the Holy Spirit in our life. And if we can walk through suffering with that perspective, that this is going to make something beautiful in my life, even though I might not understand it, if that is how we can walk through it, that's worth rejoicing. I wish I could hear a big amen. Can I get an amen on Facebook Live right now? Because this is worth rejoicing in when we move through this. And so Paul then continues on in the scripture after this great long setup for us to understand. He goes on to say, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. It produces something. We already basically covered that, that when we are suffering, when we go down that road of suffering, again, whatever that looks like, however you have been broken, however you have been hurt, however you feel like you have been crushed and pressed down upon, however that looks to you, it leads us down a path. That this is not the beginning, or the end rather. That suffering is not a void unto itself, that we suffer to suffer, but suffering is the beginning of a journey that we are down. That as we experience suffering, it's going to be producing something in our life. It's going to be growing us in a deeper way that we didn't know possible before. The scripture tells us that it's producing something and it's leading us down that path. It's leading us towards something. And Paul goes on to tell us what it is, that because we know that suffering produces something, it's producing perseverance in our life. It's giving us perseverance. And perseverance is being able to withstand that pressure. So like the olive press, when the pressure is starting to come down, it's being able to withstand that even though it's difficult. Even though that you're in the midst of something very hard, something that is difficult to understand fully, in the midst of that, you're able to withstand what's coming down on you. And the more that you're able to withstand, the more perseverance is working in your life. That this is not for a long period of time necessarily. It can go on for a while, but it's a work that is going on continually in your life, more and more. So, I'd like to share with you a little bit of a story in my life of where this kind of plays itself out a little bit. So, 20 years ago, the year was 2000, I was working at a camp in Washington State. It was Cascades Camp and Conference Center. And as I was working there, towards the end of the summer, I got some devastating news that changed the entire journey of my life. At the end of that camp, I was hospitalized because I had out-of-control blood sugars, and I was told that I had type 1 diabetes. And this changed everything in my life. Because one of the things that I wanted to do, it was actually the only thing I wanted to do in that time in my life, was I wanted to be a missionary. And not only did I want to be a missionary, I wanted to be one of those crazy missionaries that packed things in a backpack and went out into the far jungles of this world, living in my backpack and a tent and sharing the good news of Jesus Christ to the far-off tribes, just being alone in the woods, trying to find people and love people and connect with people. But I wanted to go down that path. That's what I thought about. It's what I wanted. And I was excited to figure out how to get to that place in my life. But then, I became a diabetic. And as I became a diabetic, that dream was taken away from me. I felt like that dream was taken away from me because I was no longer able to go into the far-off jungles because I needed constant medication that needed to be cooled. I needed constant watching with doctors. I had a whole lifestyle of needing very specialized care and medication. And I was crushed. And I was confused. I felt like God was angry. My dreams had broken apart. So I had lots of questions at that time in my life. And perseverance needed to kick in a little bit as I was feeling this immense amount of pressure in my dreams moving forward. Perseverance is the endurance of the pressure you are under that is changing you. This is how I would define perseverance in our lives. And it was in this, I was trying to find endurance of that pressure in my own life in the midst of the struggle that was going on. In the midst of what I was feeling as my personal suffering, my dreams being broken. And something interesting happened in the midst of that. As I was lamenting, trying to figure out what my life was going to look like moving forward, the doctor came into the room and the doctor said this to me. He said, "Mr. Mackey, you, as you know, have diabetes now, which is going to change everything about your life. But there's three things I want you to know right now that I hope will be helpful to you." And the doctor looked at me and he said, "The human is made up of three different parts, the spirit, the mind, and the body." And he said, "You just came to us from a Christian camp, so I would guess that your spirit is doing well with the Christian thing." He said, "Your mind seems to be sharp, so I think your mind is doing okay, but your body has failed you now. But I don't want you to fret." And this is what the doctor said. I quote you not, I kid you not, he quoted me this. From his memory, he said, "Mr. Mackey, you are not alone. Because the disciple Paul said this," and from memory the doctor spoke these words from 2 Corinthians 12. "I was given a thorn," these are Paul's words, "I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. Three times I pled with the Lord to take it away from me, but he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in my weakness, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong." You see, that doctor was encouraging me in the midst of what I had just heard, to persevere. To know that I was not alone in the midst of my suffering, that I was not alone in the midst of the difficulties and hardships that I was facing in that time. That I was to persevere. That I was to go forward. Because when everything around you says, "Give up, you have lost," which is what I was feeling in that midst, what perseverance says to us is, "I will find strength in God to stand back up." And the more we stand back up when we are knocked down, the more perseverance we have in our life, the more we're able to grow in our perseverance. And so as you are feeling knocked down from your difficulties, as you are feeling knocked down from your sufferings, as you're feeling pressed and crushed and broken from your sufferings, stand back up. Because when you stand back up with God holding you, you are working on your perseverance. But Paul doesn't stop there. He says that as you work on your perseverance, something else is going to be given to you. Because perseverance is going to give you character. Character is, I think, asking yourself the question, who do you want to be? In the midst of the difficulties, in the midst of the pressures that you're feeling, how do you want to be known? How do you want to be seen? Because I think that most of us can answer that question, that I was not who I wanted to be in that situation. I was not a person of character in the midst of what was going on. And so I think that building that question when you're in the midst of it, saying, am I who I am supposed to be in this time, will help you build your character. And character is the consistent choice you make. Character kind of points the finger a little bit at us during this time. Because character is a choice only we can make. It's a choice that as we're in the midst of difficulty, how we're going to respond to that difficulty. That's basically on us. And so I encourage you to continue to look at how you respond to the difficulties that you're standing. Are you able to point your finger back to God? Because that's what true character looks like in the midst of difficulties. That pressure is what's put on us, but how we respond by pointing our fingers back to Jesus, that's the character. That's how it's experienced in a really big way. So when I was in the midst of my diabetes, the story kind of ends for me in this way. Remember, I was kind of frustrated, confused, a little angry, didn't know really what to do. And in the midst of all of that, I got the opportunity to go to my aunt and uncle's house and kind of just have some space there to process this new life, to try to come to grips with it, to find perspective, to find proximity and time to think through it. And in that time, after I left their house, I flew to Washington State, and I got into the truck after I landed in Seattle, a truck I had, and I was about to drive over the mountains to a new adventure in life. I was offered the job as a youth pastor, and I was kind of confused by that because it's not really what I was going to be wanting to do long term. And in the midst of my journey over this mountain pass, I remember just all of a sudden, I was kind of angry with God. I was praying and wrestling with God in that time. And all of a sudden, I pulled my truck over at the top of this mountain pass. And there was this scenic overview. And I just got out, closed my door, probably a little harder than I should have. And I walked down this trail a little ways, and I sat down over this view. And it was one of the most incredible views I had seen. And in the midst of looking at that beauty and that grandeur, all of a sudden, the right perspective crept into my being. And I remember saying these words out loud to God in that space. I said this: I do not know, I do not understand, but I am yours. I made a promise that day, an out loud promise, that it didn't matter as long as I was yours. My perspective was, I can serve and do whatever you need me to do, however you need me to do it, it doesn't matter. Because I'm yours. Even though I don't know, even though I don't understand, it doesn't matter. And that perspective in me changed the trajectory of my life. I owned that. And I think my character was built slightly more that day as I leaned into God and I let Him control where I was headed and I let go of some of my own control. The other piece of character that I think is important is character is not wavering. That in all of the times of struggle, it's being able to point back to God. It's not wavering from following Jesus. It's not wavering from loving Him with all that we have. It's not wavering from loving our neighbor. It's not wavering from following Him in the best way we know how. It's an unwavering spirit to God. And as we live into the I will not waver from you, God, and I will point my finger back to you every opportunity I have, even in the midst of struggle, even in the midst of suffering. When we do that, that is what character looks like, pointing back to God. Paul goes on to say, and after we work on our character, finally we have hope. We end with where Paul started, back to hope. A hope that is something that is a promise that is actually given to us from Jesus. Hope is not something like our everyday language, like, I hope I get a pizza tonight. I hope we get to have a bowl of ice cream. I hope that I get to talk to the kids today. That's not the hope that this is talking about, but rather this is an assurance of truth. This is believing that God is going to do what He promised He was going to do. And I believe that what God said is really going to happen. It's an assurance, and it's knowing that God's word is true. So that when God says He's going to come back, I believe that. I hope and am assured that that is truly going to happen because I believe what God said is true. So it's an assurance in the midst of that. And he goes on to expound a little bit. He says, and hope does not disappoint us because God has poured out His love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit who has given to us. He says, that hope was poured out for us. That it's something that is given by the Holy Spirit to us. And it will not ever disappoint us. In the midst of our suffering, it will not disappoint. It will be there guiding and directing, something for us to hold on to in the midst of whatever it is we're going through. Even today, even being locked up in our houses, not being able to go nowhere, there is hope that we can hold on to in the midst of that. Because it's poured out for us, and it does not disappoint. I want to end with this. This is a verse from Romans 8:17, and I find a lot of security with this verse. It says this, now if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in His sufferings, in order that we may also share in His glory. You see, there's a connection that is made here in this verse, that we share sufferings with Jesus. So Jesus suffered. And so not only do we share in Christ's sufferings, but we also share in His glory. And this is a promise that is given to us. And it's something that I think is absolutely important for us to understand, because Jesus suffered. Everything that we have talked about today, Jesus has walked through and demonstrated those things to each and every one of us, that Jesus was mocked and spit upon and pushed and whipped and beat. He knows what suffering is. It was a physical suffering that I can't even imagine, all the way to nails being put through his hands and his feet and thorn of crowns being pushed and thrust upon his head. This is physical suffering. But he didn't just stop at physical suffering, but he had a mental and spiritual suffering that I couldn't even fathom as he was on the cross, and the moment that all of the sins that I have ever committed went upon him, the suffering that he experienced from my own individual sin being laid upon him, and not only my sin, but the sins of the world, in one moment went upon him. Could you imagine taking upon the sins of the world and the suffering that you experienced in that moment? That is a suffering that no one can fully understand. I speak about it, but the suffering is too great to even think about. So he went through physical suffering and mental suffering, and he did this because he wanted to give us relationship with him. He wanted us to be able to see that he was willing to suffer, and he persevered through that. His suffering was perseverance. He was being crushed and pressed down and broken. Everything about him shows the perseverance that he was able to walk through. And as he persevered, his character was on bright display, because the entire thing of his character was giving love and pointing back to the love of God, being able to rescue us from our own mistakes. And the character doesn't just stop with him being able to show us love by his death, but it came even later. 3 days later, as he rose from the dead, again, his character showed that nothing can stop him from coming back to bring us into relationship with him. His character of love was on bright display for us. And so as we get to experience the story of Jesus demonstrating suffering, perseverance, character, and ultimately hope that is given back to us to follow him, we have an example that is beautiful to live into. Because we are on a journey of hope, friends. For us, we get the opportunity to absolutely display in this time, in this place that we have been given right now, we have the opportunity to display perseverance and character and hope that comes from Jesus to a world who is watching us. And so I want to encourage you that as you enter into this journey of hope, that your suffering is not just suffering by itself, but your suffering is hope-filled. That your suffering is leading you down a path into hope. Because that's where we need to live. That's the perspective that we take on, that Paul has encouraged us in. We're going to end. Hopefully, I'm going to invite you all right now to listen to a song together. Our tech guy, Pastor Chip, right now is currently copying over a song from YouTube. He's posting it into our Facebook page. So when you're done with this, you can just close out of the video and check out the video. It's called Scars by a great little group. And I just want us as a church to sit and listen to that song. Because for me, it wraps up everything that we're talking about right now. It's a great way. You can sing the lyrics on the screen if you want. You can just meditate and listen to these words. But it's a space for us to wrap up together as a church. So I'm going to close this in prayer. And after that, I invite you as an entire church to click on that video and listen to it together. You might have to refresh your page to do that. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you so much for loving us, for giving us the example that suffering is not something we do in the void, but suffering leads us to a path of growth, a path of perseverance and character and hope, and that hope will never disappoint us. And so, Jesus, do the work in our hearts to identify how we can live this out more clearly as we walk alongside you. Thank you for this morning, Jesus. Amen.